Thank you, Bob, and thank you again for being with us, for staying with us today. So what I would like to do is to introduce the subject of sarcoma in the context of the disorders that we have been discussing today. But Dr. Lazar will be also presenting the molecular classification and some of the tools that we have nowadays also to keep, you know, these patients on check. Rather, what I wanted to do is to make sure that I can also present some of the new data. So I would like to take you into a journey that has spanned, you know, some 15 to 20 years. So what I would like is to start with the concept of where a tumor initiation can be in the stem cell compartment, and to use hematological malignancies to then, you know, transit into something that will be more close to home in the context of mesenchymal stem cells. To go into some of the earlier studies that we and some other colleagues did on cellular differentiation and tumor classification using more modern tools. To try to tell you why we think that there is quite a bit of confusion in resistance versus lack of response, and what may be the implications for a subset of cells that have a very specific phenotype, and which can be the translational implications of these cells looking from now into the future. So we learn a lot from the earlier studies on development, differentiation, tissue homeostasis. It's regulated by a very complex group of programs. The reality is that the area that produced some of the early definitions and assessments was the bone marrow, essentially because we had also easy access and because of the ease to obtain these cells also from the patients. What we learn is that specific cells, totipotential cells, can produce a wide variety of differentiated clones that then are the functional units. And through early immunological and molecular classifications, we learn that we can assign a specific histogenesis, a specific cell of origin, as has been demonstrated in the last group of lectures, to the malignancies that we see. So there are specific phenotypes that go with T cells or B cells. There are specific phenotypes that can identify that the cell is more differentiated or less differentiated, that has started even in a very specific location, microanatomically, in the germinal center, and so on and so forth. And that was the foundation for us to understand that at different moments in differentiation, for reasons that still we don't understand, the cell can be stopped and can be transformed. And upon this transformation, it will produce a malignant phenotype, which includes the facts that they can invade and metastasize. Through these studies, we also learn that the concentration of hematopoietic stem cells is very consistent in individuals. And actually, that this very same number is seen in leukemias. And once the tumor starts progressing or becoming more aggressive, we see, or upon treatment, that this compartment starts growing. So since that was a very crowded space, and since we thought that we had other opportunities and we wanted to expand some of these studies into other areas, we decided to do a parallel between what has been happening in the hematopoietic lineage in the context of connective tissue. And why in connective tissue? Because it has been now for over two decades in a space in which the mesenchymal compartment has been identified, and we have been able to isolate these cells, both in the human as well as in experimental model systems, essentially in the murine model systems. What has not happened until some of us arrive into this field with our questions, but also with our passion, was a further understanding of how these things develop. And we have produced through the years a molecular subclassification of sarcomas that has been able to produce very robust data, entities that were not clear that were real entities or that was essentially an area that we didn't know the pathology, such as the MFHs. It became molecularly an entity. And other entities that were essentially defined by the name were triggered by some of our thoughts. What is a clear cell sarcoma? Why we are giving a morphological description to something that can be molecular well-defined? So these were some of the early studies that we wanted to do. And these were some of the early molecular profiles in soft tissue sarcomas. What we learned was that in the same way that you can take an hematopoietic stem cell and put it in a specific condition media and differentiate them, what we can do now is we can take mesenchymal stem cells and depending on a specific condition media, we can reproduce entire lineages. So we can make, in a very specific programmatic manner, from mesenchymal stem cells, a petri dish that after 21 days, not 18, not 24, it's going to be full of adipocytes. Or after 24 days, it's going to have osteocytes or cartilage or muscle. The next step was to understand these processes. Can we produce molecular signatures that are going to be associated with these developmental programs? And through careful analysis and validation, both at the RNA and at the immunohistochemical level, at the microanatomical detail, we were able to identify a series of fat adipogenic markers from transcription factors to differentiation antigens that could define very early stages of adipocytic differentiation, intermediate or later stages. Now that we have markers and that we start understanding how we can look not only at the process developmentally, but at the tumors, this was what we did next. Molecular profiling of these lesions together with the different days of differentiation as well as normal fat allow us to start for the first time to understand that what we were calling a specific entities had very specific profiles, similarly to what we were seeing in leukemias. When you look at the differentiated liposarcomas, it appeared to be impacting on very specific differentiation days, and some of the late antigenic profiles were mostly clustering with well-differentiated round and myxoid sarcomas. In order to better define what happened, computational biologists and mathematicians have helped us with different tools. There is a tool called the minimal distance correlation analysis, in which you take the profiles of different sets and you try to find out what it's more similar to. So if you take normal fat and you take from day 0 to day 21 of full differentiation, normal fat will be very close to 21 days, which makes sense. It's the last step in differentiation. So now that we know that, if you look at well-differentiated liposarcomas, we'll also be very nearby. But what is very undifferentiated clusters with very early stages of differentiation, and so on and so forth. So for the first time, we were able to produce a temporal map in which a specific moments in differentiation are impacted, or at least specific mutations may allow that initiated cell to move under specific circumstances to a point, and then at that point to close and to produce the clones that are going to start expanding. So a new map and a new group of tools that are important for classifying the disease, but also some of them could become now targets for therapy, have produced a temporal map and are giving us a sense of where the lesion may be and which can be the lesions that can be the triggers for a stopping in a specific differentiation points. Part of the group of studies that we did while in paralleling we were doing all of this work on liposarcomas was to understand specific entities. And one of the entities that we wanted to understand was the so-called clear cell sarcoma. Clear cell sarcoma always clusters aside from the most conventional sarcoma lesions. And it was actually when I was still at Memorial that working with a group of colleagues, we expand the profiling and we try to put it all together. And it was the first evidence doing this kind of studies that clear cell sarcomas were clustering together with melanomas. And that was observed in the past by smart pathologists, which they used to call the clear cell sarcomas, the melanomas of the soft part. Through the years, we have learned that these lesions do have a perfect profile that can be compared to relatively undifferentiated melanoma lesions. If you take a series of tissues from embryonic development or adult normal tissues, and highlighted in here are profiles of melanocytes, and you compared it to sarcomas, you see no melanocytic signature in these lesions. But if you take melanomas and clear cell sarcomas, you don't know which one is which, because they have very similar developmental pathways and very similar even differentiation markers. And you can subclassify them because still they are different, but the reality is that this classification is helping us to further understand and to look now in the context of targeted therapies if these patients can benefit from some of these new developments that are happening in melanoma that include now this entity. The next group of studies that we wanted to somehow to bring some light was an entity that was supposed not to be an entity, and it was debated if we needed even to classify it as an entity. So our point was, is that an entity? Well, molecular, it is. What else can we try to understand from malignant fibrous histiocytomas? We wanted to know the origin, and we wanted to find out what would be the cell of origin, or at least early tumorigenic events, which kind of cell would impact it. Doing experimental studies and again looking for differential express genes, we realized that a bunch of them that related to stemness were very much overexpressed in the MFH compared to some other lesions. Let me tell you how some of these markers work. One of the most important pathways that delineates what line of differentiation and which tools you're going to do in arresting, it's the Wnt pathway. The Wnt pathway works with two heterodimeric molecules that produce a single receptor that then becomes the receptor for the ligand, the Wnt. That will start producing a series of signals that are going to unleash this professional blender, which is driven by the so-called APC gene, that essentially takes beta-catenin and a series of transcription factors and destroys them constantly, and does not allow them to go into the nucleus where they can produce their final functionality. There are several ways that you can disrupt that, because if that will happen, then this will go into the nucleus, it will center into its receptors, and it will start transcription of a specific genes. So one of the most important overexpressions in MFH is DKK1. So what DKK1 does? DKK1 does not sequester the ligand. What it does is that it binds to one of the receptors and does not allow the dimerization, which means that Wnt will never be activated, which means that some critical transcription factors will never be able to go into the nucleus and produce differentiation. So in that context, it maintains some kind of a stemness phenotype. In order to prove that was that our thought incorrect, mechanistic studies prove that if you take mesenchymal stem cells and you try to produce transfection and see if they are becoming tumorigenic, with a single hit, viral hit, you don't do it, but when you add a cooperative event, you know, the transfection of the gene, you produce clones. If you put these clones into murine models, they produce sarcomas, and the sarcomas that they produce are MFH sarcomas. So in other words, from our point of view, the day zero, day one, that we didn't ascribe to essentially any lesion, it's probably the cell of origin of MFH, when you hit a cell that is quite undifferentiated. So we have been able to take a mesenchymal stem cell and produce a sarcoma. Can we take a sarcoma and produce a normal cell? So this was the next group of experiments that we wanted to do, and for that, we wanted to decrease the amounts of DKK1 and increase beta-catenin. You do that by an antibody that is going to sequester DKK1 and giving lithium so you can produce a better move of this beta-catenin into the nucleus. The cells that were able to obtain that started to differentiate, and depending on the condition media that you use, they differentiated into fat, they differentiated into bone. There is already evidence for treating patients with cancer with differentiation drugs. You know, retinoic acid cures patients with specific leukemias, something that we have not tried yet in sarcomas, but I'm going to show you in a moment. That may be an interesting new strategy for some of these patients. So that about classification, understanding experimental molecular pathology. We have a better handle and a lot of tools to start asking a lot of questions. The next group of questions that we wanted to address over the years was why patients do not respond to certain therapies, why we are failing, and why we are not doing better. What can be the explanation? So pathology deals about classification, but it deals also about understanding of disease process in the context of cancer, understanding of disease origin. So we can finally treat the causation rather than continually treating the symptomatology. We have seen today that once you know the causation or mechanistic insights into the disease, you can target it now very specifically. So what are we doing wrong? Essentially in some lesions like sarcomas or melanomas, in which many patients initially respond, but then they come back. So that brought us to a series of questions. Do we know the origin of cancer? The answer is no, we don't. But can we define cancer? And the answer is yes. Cancer, even in Wikipedia, has been defined. You know, and it says that it's a clonal disease that is mostly driven by genetic mutation. It's true that some viruses have learned how to sequester some critical molecules, but the reality is that most of the diseases that we were talking today are based on the identification of driver mutations. We are also very lucky because we understand what is clonality. Clonality means one cell. So if this, you know, working hypothesis is correct, it means that cancer is a clonal disease driven by specific mutations that starts in one cell. Now the question is, which cell? Because in cell biology, you know, to introduce brain habit, it's punished by capital punishment. So cells, mature cells, when they have a mutation, they are driven into natural cell death. We call it apoptosis. If not, we would be developing cancers every minute. We have around 1 trillion cells in our body. Every day we calculated that around 1 billion cells die. So imagine the 1 billion cells that they are producing every day. So in general, these cells are very much protected against genetic manipulation. But definitely genetic manipulation exists, because when something is good, we call it polymorphism, and it has been probably the key for evolution. It's called the new view of genetic alterations and neo-Lamarckism. So could it be that a normal cell could accept genetic manipulation, become a stem cell that drives then the process? And could that cell exist, not only in tumors, but in normal tissues? So the story that I'll tell you, it's the quest for this cell over the many years, and some very interesting results that we have been producing during the last 3 to 4 years, which have been published in, you know, peer-reviewed journals of high impact. So let's first of all review what is an stem cell, because, you know, everybody tries to define the stem cells based on what they have. So they have a cell that is blue, they'll say, well, stem cells need to be blue. You know, and then, of course, you know, we have 10 definitions of stem cells, which has created a great deal of confusion in the field. So if we consider the embryonic stem cell, the ultimate stem cell for which we can produce a definition, these are the criteria that everybody accepts. And a stem cell should be an undifferentiated cell. So I still don't understand when some of my colleagues talk about epithelial stem cells that are cytokeratin positive. Doesn't fit the criteria. It needs to produce an asymmetrical division. It needs to be capable of cell renewal. This is mitotic spindle. The cell that gives rise to the daughter cells while producing the daughter cells disappears. So you start with one cell, you end up with an exponential number. An asymmetrical division is when a cell is capable of producing a different differentiated cell that then comes here, but this cell stays in its own compartment. Doesn't change. And every once in a while, instead of doing that, it's capable of producing a cell renewal without also disappearing. That's the concept of asymmetrical and cell renewal. We have identified a cell that is present in all of the tissues, it's present in all of the tumors that we have looked, that has these characteristics. Lacks markers of differentiation, produces asymmetrical division, has a stemness capability, and essentially, it's invisible to the immune system because as our embryonic stem cell, it's HLA negative. Why our embryonic stem cell is HLA negative? First of all, all of the cells in all of the bodies in this room belong to our mothers. Life is feminine in nature. Right? So what we receive from the father is a push of DNA, and as soon as the embryonic stem cell is going to start expressing paternal antigens, it's going to niche in the endometrium of the mother. If the cell is actually compatible, it will be rejected. None of us will be here. So the embryonic stem cell has learned how to downregulate the HLA and become invisible to the immune system. Where is this cell going? The cell that brought you all here, where is going? Where is it? Well, nobody has traced it with it. And it's here, it's with you. And it's an ultimate stem cell. Let me show you. Work that brought to our attention these concepts was published in the 80s. We were the first group that identify a cell that is very similar to the embryonic stem cell in many cancers, including aggressive lesions. And we have been able now to identify in the mesenchymal stem cell compartment, in sarcomas, in all of the tissues that we have looked, an important number of cells that are HLA negative. And these cells are also present in sarcomas, they are present in melanomas, they are present in gliomas, they are present in all of the tumors that we have studied. Let me show you now the functional studies that we have done so you can start relating to what may be happening in tumor initiation. This is a short movie that is going to show you how an undifferentiated cell is going to produce a differentiated cell. To the best of our knowledge, this is the first time that a movie has been produced that shows an asymmetrical division. So how we did that experiment? This is genetics 101. This is simple. It's why it's wonderful. So what we did is that we took the promoter of a differentiation antigen. It can be a cytokeratin for epithelia. It can be the CD fibrillary protein for gliomas. It can be an active isoform for sarcomas. And we added the green fluorescent protein. So we have produced a new gene that when transfected into cells that are undifferentiated and stem-like, we hope that when dividing and producing a cell that is going to be from differentiation that is negative to positive, it's going to turn green. Do you understand what is happening in here? We are transfecting a cell that is non-green with something that needs a push of differentiation, and as soon as cell is being born that it's different, because it's differentiating, it's going to turn green. Okay? Simple. So in this movie, you're going to see that this cell that already has been born is going to produce another green cell. That's mitotic spindle. But you're going to see this cell that is relatively large, that is going to take a little bit longer than a mitotic spindle. It's going to produce a cell that towards the end of 24 hours is going to be green. If you stop the click, you can see that this is becoming green. And if you go into frames, you can see that during the process of 24 hours, a new cell is born that is differentiated from a cell that was not. That, by definition, is an asymmetrical division. Now, we wanted to see if this cell could make one of itself, thus fulfilling the criteria of an stem cell. And it was a very difficult experiment. We were not succeeding until the day that somebody wanted to do what we do with patients sometimes. We started to kill the differentiated clones, in this case with taxanes. So when generals see the troops decreasing, they get very worried. So what is this cell doing in front of after several rounds of, you know, the troops dying? First, it's going to look at one more at apoptosis. These cells are going to explode in an apoptotic mode, it retires, and then this is what happens. Apoptotic modes. That's cell renewal. That's cell renewal. So if you look at this carefully, the differentiated cells have died. This cell not only has not died, but it has produced one more identical of itself. How that can happen? This cell is dividing in the presence of taxanes, which inhibit tubular polarization. Mitotic spindle cannot happen. That means that this cell renewal, it's doing it with a division machine that has still to be discovered. And if you put anything in here, this cell will divide. There is a difference between resistance and non-response. Resistance, it's an acquired phenomenon after sensitivation. You are sensitive, you become resistant. This cell, it's not that it's resistant, it doesn't care. It's a non-responder. Doesn't respond to what we are using. This is the beginning of what we call drug resistance in our patients. It's the beginning of the growth of a new clone that doesn't respond to what we have. There are several models to explain drug resistance. Somebody invented something called transition. I don't know even how to explain it. All of the cells are blue and all of a sudden there is no evidence for that. There is a Darwinian definition of selection, which you know, could be, but the reality is what would be driving that. So our model stems from the fact that you may kill differentiated cells, but a group of undifferentiated, non-responding cells keep growing, keep producing more aggressive lesions, and keep producing clones that become resistant. But this cell is not resistant, it doesn't respond, at least to what we are exposing it to. More mechanistic studies. If you take these cells alone and you transplant it into an immune-suppressed animal, or if you take the differentiated clones, the green clones, what would happen? If you take only these cells, tumors grow. But if you take the differentiated clones without these cells, tumors don't grow. Which means that the only way that you can have a tumor or produce a metastasis is if you have some of these cells. Differentiated cells, even in a tumor, are mortal. These cells are immortal in a mortal body. So how we can use this? We can use this to further understand what's happening. We have learned not only how to isolate this cell, we have learned how to characterize it and how to expand this cell. One of the ways to expand these cells and one of the ways to help the patients is by doing what we call patient-derived tumor xenografts, in which you can take a specific compartments in which lesions are going to grow, and then study these tumors and study how many of these cells are present and start enriching for these cells. The other studies that you can do is to try to target not only what we have been looking until now, which is the differentiated and the dividing compartment, the proliferative compartment. If you target only these and you leave that behind, tumors may come back. You need to target both. That's our working hypothesis, that you may want to target both. Targeting just that and not targeting this may be a reason for failure. And also important for some of the clinical trials that are ongoing, it's the fact that these cells are HLA negative, so immunology 101. As we have heard today, in order to produce and activate the cell needs to be presented by a specific antigens, either by an antigen-presenting cell or the cancer cell itself, which can be a trigger for the innate immunity. But, you know, this happens when you shake hands. You know, you need to embrace each other and translate this information. This is done only in the presence of the major histocompatibility loci. And this is how it works. And these are the cartoons from different colleagues. And we trust that. However, what will happen if this cell has no arms to shake? What happens to cells that are HLA negative? The typical response that we are seeing in at least in vitro, it's mainly dominated because of this antigen, but I just proved you that there are some cells that are HLA negative. Natural killer cells will kill these cells, probably. And these cells have a series of transcription factors and developmental programs that can be targeted. But what I'm trying to say is that maybe the failure in some of the treatments that we are seeing is because we are not treating the cause yet. And we are lucky when we cure people because we don't know better. And sometimes serendipity is wonderful. Or maybe some lesions are not what we are expecting, as we were discussing today. But the reality is that we are essentially failing in many advanced diseases, and it's because there are some troops there that they are different of what we have been looking until today. That's part of pathology. To understand disease causation so we can better classify and we can better treat the patients. And my last slide, all of that is in a way of publication right now. We have been able to take mesenchymal stem cells, we have been able to transfect them, we have been able to turn them into tumors, we have taken sarcoma cell lines, we have been treating them with a combination of retinoic acid plus some chemotherapies, and we are seeing both the conversion of an undifferentiated phenotype into a differentiated phenotype, and we have seen the reduction in the impact of these technologies that together then with antimitotic spindle, for example, drugs, can produce more permanent, maybe more specific cures, because we are targeting not just one compartment, but definitely we are targeting several other compartments. So I think that we are going to see lots of developments during the next years, not only in expression profiling, not only in trying to understand that differentiated compartment that makes 80% of the troops, but it's not going to kill you. What's going to kill you, it's in a small subset of cells that we have not been able to see, maybe until now, and that if we don't target them, are going to be the ones that are going to keep coming back and keep giving us trouble. So thank you for your attention. Thanks.